Welcome to Take the Long View with Matt Hall. This is a podcast to help reframe the way you think about your money, emotions, behavior, and time. The goal? Helping you live richly. We'll talk with the best thought leaders we know to learn from their meaningful experiences. We'll bury the vegetables of world-class thinking in stories and conversation, helping you reframe your perspective so that you too can put the odds of long-term success on your side. Today, I'm joined by Rick Hill. Rick is my business partner and in many ways, one of the best people I know on planet Earth. He is wise, kind, funny, and oozes integrity. He's had silver hair since he was 10. Just kidding, since I think he was maybe 40. And Rick Hill's originally from Wilmington, Delaware, came to St. Louis to be in the beer business as a finance executive at the once great Anheuser-Busch. He took an early retirement package in the late 90s and joined an investment firm about a year before I arrived. And then I swept him off his feet and we became lifelong friends and eventually business partners. We're going to learn a lot about Rick's experiences and his wisdom, and I'm so grateful he's here with me to share some of his gems. Rick, how's it feel to be on a podcast?
Well, it's a little bit different for me. You're a pro, you know. I listened to a few podcasts, but this is my first one being a participant.
Classic Rick Hill humility. I build you up and you bring it back down. That's one of the things I love about you. You know, your claim to fame is, well, with a lot of people who know you, is setting expectations. You have a great story that you always share with people who are getting married, and maybe you could share some of that wisdom with our audience.
Well, yeah, I think personally people are happier if they set expectations a little bit lower than they really expect, and then the reality is better than what you expect. Whether you go to a movie or anything else, if I go to a fancy movie, for example, and I like it a lot, I'll tell my friends. They asked me how did you like it. I said, well, it was pretty good. Mm-hmm. I won't say it was great, because if I say it was great, then they have high expectations. They may like the movie, but they don't have it as much as I did. So in the case of new couples getting married, my story is this: is that, you, for example, you always want when your wife is home with the young kids, for example, after you got married, had a few kids, and you want to get home to see the wife and the kids, and generally you're home by, let's say, 5:30 after work. But occasionally somebody will say, hey, let's go have a drink afterwards. Someone's having a birthday. Let's go celebrate it. And you tell your wife, I'm going to be out a little bit later on Thursday. You know, I'm going to go out with the guys and have a drink, and I'll be home a little bit later. And you expect, okay, I'll leave the office about 5. I'll have a drink about an hour. I can get home in a half hour. And you say, okay, I'll be home at 6:30. And she's saying, okay, that's okay. You're usually home at 5:30. It's only an hour later. I tell people, no, don't ever tell them 6:30. Add an extra hour, hour and a half. Say you'd be home at 7:30 or 8. And that way, if by chance you drink a little bit longer, that you have traffic coming home, and you get home, let's say it's 7:15, and she's so happy you're home before 7:30 or 8, and otherwise she'd be very upset if you saw 6:30 and you get home at 7:30 or 7:15. So always extend the time a little bit, at least an hour, because my experience is things always take longer.
Exactly. I love that advice. Sounds so simple too, but it pains people to add that extra hour, because you know the initial reaction is going to be, ooh, that late? But then you're always golden.
Yeah.
You're almost always going to be on time. Speaking of on time, you know, let's talk about that for a second. The old Anheuser-Busch story about time and what being on time means. You want to tell one of those stories?
Yeah, sure. That's one thing you learned at Anheuser-Busch was, you know, you have a lot of meetings, so you never wanted to be, you know, on time. You were late. So the saying to Anheuser-Busch was, if you're 15 minutes early, you're on time. If you're on time, you're actually late. And a good example of this was one time we were flying the company plane here in St. Louis, and we had like a 7:15 departure from the terminal. It's a small terminal, no activity there other than our plane. And so everybody got there about 6:45 to make sure you're on. And you got in the plane around 7 o'clock, and August Busch comes on around 7 o'clock, and We got one more person who hasn't quite made it, August. I see him pull up in the parking lot right now. Here he comes, August. August says, he's late, let's go. So the guy starts running toward the airplane, waving his hands, and the pilot says, should I go, August? He says, keep going. So the guy, I felt sorry, we all kept very quiet. That guy kind of put his head down and walked back to his car.
Wow. Wow. If you're early, you're on time.
That's right. So I feel that way even now, you know, meeting friends for dinner or something like that. And they say, meet you at 7 o'clock. I'm always there by 6:45. And I'm always usually the first one at any kind of meeting or any kind of social event.
I love those stories. Okay, well, let's go back in time a little bit before we met. You're originally from Delaware. What do you remember from life in Delaware as a kid?
Well, it's a small city. It's a lot like St. Louis as far as it's dominated by big companies. DuPont was the main company in Wilmington. It's kind of like Anheuser-Busch was when I came to St. Louis. But it's near the Philadelphia and the East Coast, obviously. So it's a lot. My background was, you know, going to the beach in New Jersey and the shore, and you know. But I left Wilmington, Delaware, you know, after I went to college, and so I didn't really go back there after I turned like 20. Mm-hmm. But a lot of my friends still live there, but I like going back to visit them. But generally, when I moved to St. Louis and with Anheuser-Busch, we pretty much left the East Coast.
Mm-hmm. But you went to Wake Forest for undergrad. Do you have a good experience there?
Yeah, I did. I liked it. Small college, but it played, you know, big time sports, and I've always loved sports personally, either playing them or watching them. So it gave me that, you know, interest in, you know, watching them play. I liked the school. I liked the people. I definitely was in the South. I didn't realize when I went there how much I was in the South, because everybody kept saying, where are you from? And I said, I'm from Delaware. And they said, are you a Yankee? And I said, I don't know, I'm a Yankee. I guess I am. So I never realized they're still fighting the Civil War down there. And they know whether you're a Yankee or, you know, a Southerner. So, but I learned that quickly. So, yeah, but I did enjoy the school, though.
And then after Wake Forest, eventually you find your way to Wharton for business school.
Yeah, I was planning on actually going into the Army, but I was declared 4F in ROTC after my junior year at doing that at summer camp. I had a detached retina in my eyes, and that didn't qualify me for service. So I had to rearrange my plans, and I decided to go to graduate school. Went to Wharton, which I enjoyed. It was. I must admit that was a place where I really felt like I had to study hard and really work. And time where I put a lot of effort into getting through that in 2 years.
So you come out of Wharton, you got a fancy MBA from a great school, and then what?
Well, when I was getting ready to graduate, the one class I had at Wharton, which I really liked a lot, was an investment class. And it was the back then, of course, this is now back in the mid 60s. This is where you didn't have, you know, iPhones or anything technology. And one of the classes we had was try to analyze a company and said, okay, look at the annual report, go to the library, get all the information you can on a company, and tell me whether you would buy that stock or sell that stock. And so since my dad worked for DuPont, I said, I think I'll pick DuPont. And I picked DuPont, and I did all this analysis, and I came back, and I said, I wrote a paper about, I think the stock's too high priced. I would sell it. And I went back to my father, and I said, Dad, I think you ought to get rid of all your DuPont stock. And he said, yeah, you crazy? The company's done a lot of research, new products coming out. It's done well over the last, you know, 25 years. I'm not selling my stock. It always goes up. Well, over the next six months, the stock dropped about 30%. And my dad didn't sell, and he said to me at one point, he said, I should have followed your advice. Well, the problem with that was I thought I was very smart. I was probably more lucky than smart, but because I made the decision to sell. I would have sold, but looking back on that decision, I realize now it was just lucky that it did go down over the next 6 months. Anyway, but I did like the class. I kind of liked just staying on top of things, you know, reading the paper about the economics and just hearing the news going on in the world, you know. So when I left Wharton, I went to become a stockbroker. And I thought my idea then was, okay, you've got all this education. You can now begin to advise people on how to put together, you know, a plan to invest their money. And I went to work for Dean Witter in Philadelphia. And I had a 6-week training program in New York City. And I figured I'll go up there and I'm going to learn a lot about how to put stocks together in a portfolio and how to analyze stocks. Well, what happened those 6 weeks is all about how to sell, how to respond to questions, how to make cold calls. Not one thing did they bring out any finance, anything to do with finance. It was all marketing. And when I started to do my job in Philadelphia, went back to Philadelphia, I enjoyed, doing some of it, but it was all just, you had to be constantly selling and you had to talk to your friends. And most of my clients were my parents' friends, really. And so I did it for like 3 years. I used to do cold calling at night, making phone calls to like 50 people. I didn't even know at all. Back then, it was not as bad as it is today. People didn't get that many cold calls, so people would talk to you, but it was just it wasn't my strength as far as what I liked doing.
Yeah, knowing you, I feel like that was probably torture.
I think what happens is you used to get out what they call reverse directory of the phone book. So you look at what streets in Philadelphia were kind of, had nice areas to live. And I would start calling, and the first call was always the hardest. And then as you got going, then it got easier at the second or third call, but it was very stressful. But I had, you kind of get it. You have a little, like a marketing or sales strategy. And, what happens occasionally, someone would say, yes, I would like to hear from you. Call me back and have a good stock tip or something like that. All we recommended was individual stocks. There was nothing else other than here's a stock that we think is a good buy today. But it was not a way that I could see my future. I could not do it very long. Mm-hmm. And what happened to me then was I enjoyed the first couple of years, but what happened was in 1969, is when the Dow Jones almost hit 1,000. It's hard to believe it was that low. It was 25,000 today. But back then, it got to be like 995. And we were thinking, oh, hey, kid, it's going to hit 1,000. It's going to be a big day in the market, Well, over the next, 6 or 7 months, it dropped 35% back to 600 and something. And I remember every one of my clients, I started in 67, every one of my clients was in a negative territory. All had lost money. And most of my clients, as I mentioned, were my parents, friends of my parents. So I always felt bad going back to Wilmington, Delaware and seeing them. A lot of them were neighbors. And they always come, hey, Rick, what's going on with my stocks? And so what I did was I used to tell my parents, I'm coming home this weekend, open up the garage door, I'm going to pull the car in, I don't want anybody to know I'm home. Because I don't want them to come bug me. Because I can't give them any kind of advice. I'm just sorry, it's down, too bad. So I didn't want to say that. So I pretty much stayed, in the dark for my parents' friends.
And yet, the whole industry at that time really didn't know anything about what we'll talk a little bit more about in a minute about efficient market theory, and mutual funds were either just getting going or not really a part of the popular strategy for investors. Most people did pick stocks, had no underlying philosophy, and so you weren't doing anything that was any different from what the norm was in the country. But knowing you, my guess is what was hurtful or shameful in some way was you couldn't, outthink what was happening in the market. You couldn't, there was no strategy that could defend you from what was happening.
Yeah, it's hard to imagine, but back in the late 60s, finance was pretty much in the dark ages, really. A lot of the studies have come out like Bill Sharpe won the Nobel Prize in 1990. Fama French, they came out with all these papers later on. So nobody had any idea how to really do anything other than buy stocks. I mean, there's very few articles written about, using even index funds didn't exist. They didn't start until the 70s. So it was definitely the dark ages. And everybody just bought stocks and U.S. stocks. Nobody bought bonds.
And the training you received, as you said, was training on sales.
Yeah.
Not on a way to think or invest properly. And you are, as I said in the introduction, you ooze trust and integrity. And so your aim is so true with respect to helping others. You know, before we were doing this podcast, I asked some of the people we work with about what they feel after they're around you, what they're left with, what the residue is. And they just said, you have such a selflessness and a generosity of care for others that they, I mean, no, everybody that works with you loves you. And I think as I reflect back on you in this position, it's like how, I can't imagine how hard that must have been to not have a strategy to be able to help people you knew you really were aimed at serving. You weren't really a salesperson.
Yeah, I still can think back, this has been 50 years now, 1969, going to my branch manager in Dean Witter in Philadelphia and saying to him, what should I do? All these stocks I'm recommending are going down. What's a good strategy? He looked at me like, what do you mean a strategy? Just keep trading.
Yeah.
Keep selling what you, if you own the stock, sell. If you want to buy something else.
Yeah.
He said, if you can't stand this kind of, you know, do that, you're in the wrong business. And I think that was right. I was definitely in the wrong business.
At that time.
At that time.
Okay, so let's jump forward. Let's get out of that business back in the 60s, and let's go to the beer business, and let's move to St. Louis. How'd that come about?
Well, I told my wife, I said, I think I'm going to quit my job. But back, you know, in those days, the husband kind of made the decision. I mean, not a lot of my friends, I always said, you know, they kind of enjoyed this. My back then, it was kind of, I saw my wife, I think I need to quit this job, move somewhere else. And she was said, okay. We got two young kids at that time. Where do you want to live? I said, well, anywhere but New York City and like in Alaska, something like that. So I sent out like 300 letters to companies, you know, and most of them said, thanks, we have nothing available. Keep your resume on file for a year. But actually, Wharton had an alumni, you know, placement service, and they had a job at Anheuser-Busch, and I applied for it, and I got an interview, and I got the job. Knew nothing about St. Louis, and all our friends kept saying, "I'm too bad you're leaving New Jersey. You're going to or Philadelphia. You're going to St. Louis." People in St. Louis said, "Aren't you happy you're here versus living in Philadelphia?" So it depends on where you live. Mm-hmm. But I feel very fortunate in picking Anheuser-Busch, being hired by Anheuser-Busch, because it was when I joined Anheuser-Busch, which was I had 18% market share, and when I left 25 years later, had a 48% market share. So it was a very growing, it was a growth environment, adding new breweries, new beer products, new divisions. So it was a very good time to be at Anheuser-Busch.
Mm-hmm. And there was a real, I mean, I would imagine when you moved to St. Louis and you said, I work for the brewery, that had a certain amount of prestige to it. You know, that would be a good story to tell when you were walking around or making new friends. I mean, there was certainly a good amount of civic pride and, you know, just good feeling around the brewery. Did you sense that when you came to St. Louis?
Yeah, that was a big surprise to me because I just thought Anheuser-Busch was just another company.
Right.
Because I looked at other companies that I could have worked for at that time. But so we moved into St. Louis in November. And we were unpacking our car, you know, and our neighbors came by and they all welcomed us in the neighborhood. And they said, what brings you to St. Louis? I said, well, I'm going to start working for Anheuser-Busch. And all the men said, Anheuser-Busch, how'd you get that job? I said, what do you mean? He says, I applied and I got it. I said, oh my God, that's a great company. If you hear any openings, let me know. I want to work there. Well, I had no idea. I mean, I just said, it's a company that sells beer. What's the big deal? But yeah, it was a great company for St. Louis. You know, as you said, it's all the supports the charities in St. Louis and owns the baseball team, you know, and they did a lot for St. Louis. I look back on, I left before it was acquired by InBev, but it's a shame that, you know, it's no longer the company it was back when I was there.
But you made a lot of great friends, had amazing experiences. And I think one of the coolest things, and we tell this story a lot about the brewery, is back in the mid 80s, they made a really brave decision with how they manage their own money. And I think this is great foreshadowing for what comes in your own future. Can you tell us a little bit about the story of how the brewery managed their money and how they made a really important decision that was in many ways ahead of its time?
Yeah, this gets us back into the kind of the investment field. When I was I was the assistant treasurer of Anheuser-Busch, and in the treasurer group, we did an analysis. The pension committee of Anheuser-Busch said, you know, we want you somebody to look at our how we invest our money. We haven't done that well investing money the last, you know, 10, 15 years. Is there a better way to do it? And because what they said was, you know, we have a consultant that identifies the best money managers for our pension. They can identify the best active fund manager and the best international fund manager. And they've beaten their benchmarks over the last, you know, 3 and 5 years. And we give them money. In the next couple of years, they don't do that well. And we got to replace the consultant says, we want to replace this one manager that hasn't done that well. We got somebody better now. And so they kept moving money around, but never did that well. So we did a study, and what they found was that buying just the index funds or buying the benchmarks was better than trying to pay all these high fees for the active managers. And so they fired the consultant, they fired the active managers and went straight to index funds for the pension plan. And then they also changed in the 401k options for the employees. Every one of they got rid of all the active funds in the 401k plan, and went to all pure index funds, except for you could still buy Anheuser-Busch stock. So I saw this results of the study, and I had been still picking stocks up until then. I thought I could still, you know, study the markets and do well by picking stocks. I looked at all this evidence they presented to the pension committee. I said, wait a minute, this looks so overwhelming. Why would I try to pick stocks when it shows that the benchmarks wins almost every time, not all every time, but the high majority of the time it's won by the index funds. So I sold all my individual stocks, and all I did was buy index funds. And so from that point on, I said that I'm not going to spend all my time doing all this extra work I was doing trying to pick the stocks.
What an amazing decision that the brewery made at a time when it wasn't quite as popular as it is now. I think now people say, oh yeah, I've seen some of the evidence, or I know that most active managers can't beat their benchmarks, or individual stock pickers can't keep pace with a simple average. But getting that lesson a long, long time ago was probably hugely valuable. I think at one point you may have said to me, well, you say it. Have you made more money as a worker or as an investor?
Well, definitely as an investor. I think that's one of the things that, you know, a lot of people who start their own business, that they think they make their money from the business. But in my case, I made most of my money as an investor. That's one thing I learned at Wharton also, is the benefit of compound interest. I mean, you don't realize if you just take the long view and put money in over time, let it grow, it's amazing how much you can accumulate money just by being patient and taking advantage of the compound interest.
Yeah, it's boring, but it works.
Yes, Bill Sharpe won the Nobel Prize. It's a boring way to get rich. Mm-hmm. You can't brag to your friends about, I bought this stock at 50 and it's now 75, but it's the best way to invest, but you have to have humility that you can't beat the market.
But that's one of the cool things I think about your experience, though, is that Dean Witter experience before you came to Anheuser-Busch helped create some of that humility. Whereas our friend Larry Swedrow has said, it's tuition. Some of the money that you lose in buying individual stocks, which is eventually you're likely to lose money because it's difficult to outperform the benchmark. Some of that lost money is really tuition. You learn a very valuable lesson. And that humility may have really set you up for openness at Anheuser-Busch as you saw the data and evidence that told a story that was different from what you learned and what was conventional wisdom at the time.
Yeah, and I think in addition to helping you as an investor, it also, I think, frees up a lot of time. Because what I figured out after I got the evidence about, you know, buying index funds rather than individual stocks, I went back and looked at all the time I spent reading financial magazines, getting bearings on the weekend and going through that page by page, going to economic forecast lunches given by banks here in St. Louis. I figured I spent 240 hours a year in what I consider kind of wasteful, had no value, wasteful time, which is roughly 6 weeks of my life, 40 hours a week, was really had no value. And so besides getting me, I think, a better investment plan, it freed up a lot of time to do other things in my life, whether it was, you know, doing more at work or doing more with my family or doing more just activities. It's really a, it's a game changer as far as time, saving time, trying to do other things. If you once you believe this philosophy of getting access to the market in a low cost way, it saves a lot of. And once you believe it, honestly believe it, it saves you time.
Yeah, I think that's so cool because that's really where the strategy intersects with life. And that's one of the most, I think, rewarding pieces of this puzzle. Okay, so let's keep going. So now you're at Anheuser-Busch, you're super successful, you're a big muckety-muck, and you got all these stock options, and you're investing in a sort of indexy, passive way. Life's good. You live in a perfect little house in a nice neighborhood in St. Louis. You're married to an awesome woman. By the way, this is a cool thing Rick told me once. I think this is such a nice thing for any husband or partner to say. Early on when we met, Rick said, if you like me, wait till you meet my wife. She's my secret weapon. And I think that's true. Lynn Hill, Rick's wife, is an awesome partner. I think also, I think in many ways, you're my second marriage. In both relationships, one of the cool things is when you have shared values and complementary skills, and you and Lynn certainly have that, and I think in some ways we have that.
Yeah, well, thanks for saying that. I think it's, when I first met you, that's what it was. I think we liked each other just on a personal basis. We like to do things together, talk, had the same interest as far as, you know, talking, and we played golf together and tennis, but we were different people as far as our skill sets.
Totally different.
But we all had the same values as far as, you know, doing what's right for the client, being honest and truthful, you know, and doing all those things. But as far as activity wise, I enjoy more the financial aspects of it. I really enjoy trying to like solve problems, you might say. And I used to, at Anheuser-Busch, I just used to like to get a situation and just figure something out, you know, or do a project. Well, you're so good at the marketing and, you know, sales side and just the communication side, which I don't mind. I'm better at it than I was, you know, maybe 25 years ago at the meeting you probably, but I just...
I think we've rubbed off on each other in really good ways.
Yeah.
Okay, but let's, before we jump to when we get going, let's go back to, you're at Anheuser-Busch, and how do you decide to get out of there? You got this dream gig, you're in this cool business, you're in the beer business, and it's successful, it's a dominant player in the world. What are you going to do?
Yeah, at age 55... At that point, I had been there almost 25 years, so I kind of was eligible at that point to leave and still keep most of my pension. I kept my health benefits at that time. So I told my wife, Lynn, I said, what do you want to do? I said, she was teaching school then, and I said, you know, I could leave Anheuser-Busch. We could, you know, our kids, we had two kids, both of them out of state. I said, we can move to live by one of them. We could, you know, travel. We could do something else. You could quit your job. We could both do anything we want to do. And it's a little bit frightening sometimes to have a complete freedom to do anything. And we both agree, we like St. Louis. She said, I'll quit my job so we can then we can travel a little bit more on day. We were kind of limited when she was teaching school. So I said, well, I still like to do something. I just don't want to, get away from the hassle of Anheuser-Busch, you know, the long hours there. So I said, I think I might want to get back in the investment side, which, you know, as you said, I didn't want to get back in the sales side of investing, but I said, maybe, I think there's other opportunities in investing, maybe being more like an advisor and getting away from the marketing side of it. So I started taking these tests for the CFP, and I did that. Then I started looking around for just opportunities to work. And I started going to, you know, brokerage firms and banks and CPA firms that had, you know, an investment office in there with their practice. And they all said to me, yeah, you'd be great here. You got the experience. You got the Anheuser-Busch connections. You got the education. This would be great. Yeah, I'd love to have you come work for us. I said, well, that's great. I'd like to try that also. I said, but one thing I want to make clear, I want to recommend, you know, index funds for my clients. They looked at me and said, index funds? You don't make any money doing that. I said, come on, you got to sell our products, our proprietary products. You got to sell active funds. That's your decision, fella. You won't make any money doing index funds. And I said, well, I just don't feel right other than selling those products. And they said, okay, well, that's your call, but good luck. But luckily, they found this one firm, Buckingham, which did have the same philosophy. It's not quite index funds, but it's actually even better than index funds, I felt, once I got there. It's a little bit more of an enhancement, taking the best sides of index funds as far as being, you know, low cost, low tax impact, you know, take the hold for the long term. So I went to work for Buckingham, and my idea was maybe I'd work, you know, I don't know, 5 years, let's say, just to do something, just to keep active, and that's where I got back in the investment business.
Mm-hmm. But in a whole different way.
Yeah, it was more. It was definitely more to my strengths as far as, you know, helping clients with, you know, their investment plans. You know, getting a little bit a closer connection to clients, knowing what their goals were, developing a plan for them to achieve what they wanted to do with their money.
And how, for you, was this chapter of your life different from your corporate experience?
Well, the big difference then was when I worked for Anheuser-Busch, I felt like I was working for like one boss. I had to, you know, please him and, you know, satisfy his desires, and, you know, and when I started working for in a broker in back with Buckingham or back in the investment, it was felt like I had to work for the public. That's why I made a comment like, this is a little bit tougher. This is a little bit different. I wasn't expecting I need to have, rather than one boss, maybe I had, you know, 50 or 60 bosses. I had to please that many people. So I must admit, initially, I had a little bit of a transition to do that. But once I accepted that, then I got a lot of satisfaction because you're making a difference in those lives. That's the thing. And Anheuser-Busch, you felt like, okay, I'm a small fish in a big pond. But here, now what I feel like is, you know, you're an important part of this company's future, really. And advice you give them is going to make a big difference in their lives. And so it's a great satisfaction that I didn't expect to quite get. But I do, it took me a little bit of time to adjust, but now I do like it a lot now.
And did you really, at the time you were kind of coming into this, understand how emotional and behavioral this world is? You know, I think there obviously you have great technical strengths, but as we were kind of working together at Buckingham back in those days, was it ever puzzling to you, especially, you know, some of the data that would come out and say that investors' returns were so lousy in large part, not because they would have bad strategy necessarily, but because they had bad behavior. Was that something you understood, or was that new to you?
I think it was probably new to me, really. I think the one thing is, everybody has different risk profiles and different ways they react to things. And it's the big value that we provide really is to get people to, as best they can, to ignore the emotions, ignore the fear when things go bad. It's not easy. What I've learned, it's almost impossible.
Yeah.
When you get a bad situation like the market's going down, there's been studies showing that really it's almost like a snake is going across your foot when you see a bad market. And so, and even people who are, you know, PhDs and teaching professors at, you know, these big business schools, they have the same feelings that they tend to get. Like I read an article about during the tech increase back in the early 2000 period when they were going, tech stocks were doing very well. Even these people who knew that this was high risk would buy the stocks because all their neighbors kept saying they bought a stock at 30 and it's now 50. They couldn't avoid it. They had to be part of the people buying those stocks. So I think it's emotion is something you just can't control, and so you have to, best you can, ignore it. As long as you have a good plan, you can ignore it. If you don't have a good plan, then obviously you're in trouble. But if you have a good plan, the best advice is just to stay the course.
Yeah. Switching gears for one second, you have a funny part of your habits, I guess, that is connected to controlling emotion. You want to tell people about your obsession with taping sports?
Yeah, well, one of the things that, actually, I just took for stress, and just, you know, I got an annual physical, and I had to fill out an app, you know, like an 8-page, you know, input form to show all the medications you're on and what drugs you take, you know, and your health, you know, as far as exercise and like that. One of the questions was, what about your stress level? How much stress do you have in your job, your daily life? And I, a scale of 1 to 10, I put down like a 2. And then it says, when does your stress occur? And I said, when I play golf. And I think one way I got rid of stress also, the other time I have stress also is when I watch sporting events, when I watch my favorite teams play a sport, I noticed I did get very excited. And so what I've done over, this has happened maybe 25 years ago, I said, I'm not going to watch any live event that my teams play. I'm like, I'm going to tape the game. So I tape it. At the end of the game, I'll then very carefully get on my TV or my iPhone and I try to say, who won the game? Not knowing what the score was. And I see who won the game. If my team won the game, I turn off the, you know, my iPhone, let's say, and then I can put the game back on and very relaxed, you know, watch the game, very, very enjoyable, you know, take a break, you know, I don't care who's ahead at the halftime, you know, and it's just so relaxing. Now, if they lost the game, I won't watch it. So my only stress is like 10 seconds when I'm putting my iPhone on and looking who won. But I think personally, it's a great way to watch games. It saves a lot of time if your team loses, and you just, the games themselves, you miss a little bit of the excitement, but it really is so much enjoyable to know that your team's going to win eventually.
Yeah. I always give you a hard time about that, but I love that that's been a part of your routine for a long, long time. You were one of those guys, you had more VCRs than anybody I knew before the DVR came in to reality. You had more VCRs going than anyone I know.
Well, but yeah, before they had, you know, the DVRs and that kind of stuff, I bought two of those taping machines, and I'd have going, you know, I'd have one going and watching the other one, have the other one going, switching back and forth. Yeah, I'm kind of obnoxious about it. I always tell my wife, when the game's going on, please do not tell me. I have to turn off all my electronic equipment. Keep it. I'm in, you know, silent mode for about 4 hours.
Okay, so shameless plug. I talk a little bit about this next part in Odds On, The Making of an Evidence-Based Investor, the book I wrote a few years ago. So if people want more detail on this, you check that out. But we became friends in 1999. That's when we met. You want to talk a little bit about that phase and a little bit about what you think maybe sort of connected us?
Yeah, I think we met at Buckingham. I'd been there, let's say, a year maybe before you joined. And what I recall is that I would, and like during like lunchtime, I would be sitting in my, you know, cubicle, let's say my office, like probably a cubicle more than anything, and I'd be reading the Wall Street Journal, kind of getting caught up, you know, relaxing, you know, just taking a little bit of break. You'd come by and say, hey, let's get some lunch. I said, okay, let's go to lunch. I wasn't that excited, but I said, I'd love to read the Wall Street Journal. So I would go to lunch with you. And then—
Yeah, just to be clear, what you're saying is you liked being by yourself and reading your paper. And I interrupted that experience for you and said, I think you'd have more fun if we did something together.
Right.
Yeah.
And if I went to lunch, generally I'd go to lunch for maybe like 20 minutes, a half hour. I'd go to, you know, just get a quick sandwich and get back to the office. With you, it took it like an hour, hour and a half, it seemed like. But I must admit, Matt, you did, you know, loosen me up a little bit. And so we kind of met that way, you know, at lunch. We talked, you know, about our lives, you know, and our background, you know, and maybe, you know, your story about how you got there, and of course in the book about, you know, how life was like on the active side, and I could relate to that because that was the way my life was like when I was back there, you know, 30 years prior probably. But then, you know, I said what I remember is that we used to go to lunch together. Generally, we tried to do lunch together, but what happened was other people said, hey, you're going to lunch? I'll go with you. So we always had seems to have about 5 or 6 people going to lunch with us. So we never really talked that much about ourselves as much as we did initially. But we had a good time. We had people going to lunch with us, and then over the years, it's been about a couple of years, 2 or 3 years together doing that. We said, you know, I think you were the one that might have brought it up initially. We were together, and you said, "What do you think about starting our own firm?" And it, you know, I had not entered my mind at all. I was thinking, I guess around 60 at that time. I was thinking, well, I'd just keep working for a few more years and, you know, go off in the sunset. But as we talked, it made a little sense, you know. And then eventually we said, let's get more serious. So we started meeting for breakfast every Saturday morning for like, I mean, this went on for like a year. And it probably seemed like 5 years to you. But Anheuser-Busch is a, one thing I learned about Anheuser-Busch was how to plan. Big on planning. You know, they used to do 5-year plans, you know, constantly updating the five-year plan. So I said, I think we better, it sounds like this could make sense, but let's plan this thing out. So we would meet every Saturday, and I'd bring along all my notes and my you know, my questions for you, you know. We would meet for breakfast, you know, and then we kept doing it all, you know, for, and I guess our wives thought we were crazy, I don't know, but we kept doing that. And it started coming together, because the big thing about why it made sense was, you know, I had the financial background, I had the clients, you had all the experience knowing how you worked with all these other RIAs all over the country and how they operate, and you had all the operations experience. So it did make a great fit for us to get going as far from a business point of view. I think my concern only was we were friends already, and I didn't want, you know, you hate to have ruin a friendship by starting a business if we don't get along for whatever reason. But we said, we like each other, let's go ahead and do it. So I remember that it was a constant. I don't know when you felt, let's do it. It kind of grew on me, you might say. But once I saw that we could do it financially and we could stay friends, I thought, let's go ahead and make the decision and approach our prior firm, Buckingham, that we're leaving.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I think one of the things you said to me was you'd been a W-2 employee your whole life, and if you were ever going to do something different, now was a good time. And I really felt like if I was ever going to do something entrepreneurial, you were the best person to do it with. And I think, again, our aim was really true. You know, your experience and my past experience, we both wanted to really serve and educate people on this approach that we thought could make a real positive difference in their lives. And I think together we thought we were on a mission. Yeah. And almost, you know, in a strange way, I never had that much doubt, actually, that we would be good together. It was just a matter of would it catch on or would we be able to build the business. But we knew we had fun together. We knew we were both bonded by the same sort of mission and purpose. And we knew we loved, you know, applying what we knew to real life situations. So I knew it was going to be fun. The question was, would it be successful as a business? But we were having a good time at the place where we worked. We left because we saw a better opportunity, not because we had a problem. But
yeah.
June of 2005, that's when we decided to leave. And we always referred to the day we were leaving as D-Day, and yet I don't think we realized what.
It was D-Day.
Yeah, the actual day we left was really D-Day. I mean,
I know.
Maybe subconsciously it was there.
We didn't acknowledge it until
the day we went to talk to the people we were working with and tell them we were going to start our own firm. So we get going, and we get going where? Where did we start our firm?
Well, yeah, but the big thing there was we weren't quite sure, you know, how they would react to our decision. And we thought, well, we didn't want to commit to a lot of, you know, long-term lease on an office building, let's say. So we said, okay, I was building a new house at the exact same time as being completed June of 05. So let's work in my basement. So actually, as we built the house, we did add a few extra, you know, features like some, you know, wires and lines.
Oh, yeah. You got a basement that is wired for major activity, thanks to us.
Yeah. So we notified our prior employers we wanted to start our own firm, you know. They were very, you know, very amicable separation. They were very supportive, and that which was a relief to both of us. And so we started, but we started in our basement. And we had, you know, all the electronic equipment, we had computers and printing machines. And so the question there was, would clients want to leave an established firm and go with two guys working in the basement?
Yeah, that's a legitimate question.
And we always said, well, great business either start in the garage or the basement. We started ours in the basement. Fortunately, almost every client of mine said, I'll go with you. Because we weren't changing any philosophy, we were just changing, you know, the location, really. But luckily, all of them felt the same way. Yeah, I like the philosophy. We're not going to change that. Yeah, I like you guys. So that was a relief when our clients kept saying, yes, yes, go with you all. And so, but for the like 6-7 months, we were in the basement. And, you know, I would get up in the morning. I was different also. I mean, I used to, so used to getting up, getting dressed, going and driving the car. And I had to get up, get dressed, take a shower, and go downstairs and wait for you to come over. And then I'd be in the basement working hard, you know, looking at different things. And I'd hear you knock. I'd hear you come through the garage or come through the front door. And Lynn would be there talking to you. And I'd say, okay, well, Matt's here. Good. And it'd be a half hour later, and you hadn't come down. I said, where in the heck is that guy? He's still talking to Lynn. Come on down. And I was thinking, what is he doing up there? And you'd come down, you know, and then we'd start working, you know. And so, but it was one of those things where I wasn't sure whether my wife would like us being there, but she loved it. She loved talking to you and loved, you know, us being there. And so the first 6-7 months, really, it worked out well. We had clients come by and visit our house, you know. We had client meetings there. And so really, it worked out. It's a great way to start a business until we decided, okay, let's make this a little bit more official. We rented it, you know, got into an office building and rented the space.
What I think's pretty cool is if you think now you're, you know, 76, still a hugely important piece of the puzzle at Hill Investment Group. And I was thinking about our vision and mission and values, and not a lot's changed.
No, if you look, I look back in our, you know, original, you know, planning back in 05, and the mission of our firm always was, you know, to get people and clients to, you know, kind of ignore Wall Street and just go out and do their, you know, enjoy their lives, spend time where it's more valuable, like their families and their kids and their activities and work. It takes them, you know, most of our clients come in with, you know, that investing is all part of their life. I mean, they come in with, you know, all their financial statements, you know, and they have both the time and the worry, and just, you know, and we try. And what I like is clients now come in with, you know, they walk in with their Bermuda shorts, they've been on the golf course, you know, or doing some charity work, you know, and they have nothing in their hands other than maybe a pencil, and they just sit down, we talk to them, you know, and they just, it just, you can see that their life is better. So I think that's one thing, nice thing about this philosophy. Once you believe it and once you see it, then you can, the emotion is, you still feel bad when the market goes down, I think, but a lot less stress and emotional attachment to your investments. Mm-hmm. You know, you can't control it. People generally think they can control the markets, you know, but you just got to accept that you cannot control what happens in the markets. It will do well if you stay the course.
I remember when we started, I think you said something to me like, I'll commit to you for 5 years. And here we are many, many years later. Do you have friends who ever ask you why you're still working?
Not as many as I thought I would, because most of my friends, I mean, all my friends are retired. And but I think they all feel, I think what they feel is, they can see I enjoy what I'm doing. They might talk to my wife about that. They don't talk to me directly as much, but this is well beyond, my work life is well beyond anything I anticipated, either at Anheuser-Busch or when I started with Buckingham or when I started with our firm. And I do recall I said, I'll give you at least definitely 5 years so we can get this business started, you know, and then we can see how it goes. But because now it's been 14 years. But it's one of those things where I enjoy it so much. You know, I get up in the morning, and I know I'm excited about getting up, going to work, and then I enjoy being with the people at work. I enjoy our coworkers, I enjoy our clients. When I get calls from a client, it's always generally, even the market's going down, it's always a pleasant phone call. So people always, I think, appreciate what we're doing. And when I drive home, I always used to think back on my day at Anheuser-Busch, and even now, was I productive today? Did I add value to somebody? Did I help, you know, a client? Did I help a coworker? Did I contribute anything to the firm or to the clients? And I always feel the answer is yes. So as long as I feel that way, and I have personal time to do the things I like doing, there's nothing better I'd rather do than do this. And I think it's helped me health-wise, you know, mentally, keeping mentally sharp. So really, I mean, a lot of my friends now, you know, having health issues, you know, unfortunately, you know, with either help hip or knees, you know, or something else. But so I think, and everything I read about, you know, retiring is the biggest concern is people do can have problems. And so but I always ask people who I know who are retired, how do you like retirement? And what do you do? That's always a question when I meet anybody new. When I play golf, Lynn and I play golf together, another couple may join us. You know, I have two couples. When I'm in California, we go to Palm Desert. And when I see another couple in the golf cart and I can see that they're retired, they have a fancy golf cart with the headlights and everything else. So I always ask them, you know, where you're from, you know, what do you do, you know, and when do you retire? And then if they're friendly enough, I keep asking, do you enjoy retirement? And most of them say, yes, they do enjoy retirement. I say, what do you do? What do you do in a typical week? What's it like? And I remember this one gentleman from Chicago said, well, I play golf, you know, four times a week. My wife and I play bridge the other couple of days a week. I play bingo two or three nights a week at the club. And as he's and I take a nap about five times a week. And as he's talking, I'm thinking, this doesn't sound very exciting to me. I said, it must be better than this. But so I can't find anything better to do. And I just think that, you know, at my age, I can still contribute. I mean, if I felt like I wasn't contributing, I wouldn't do it, I think. But I think my age gives me some advantage where you've been through like multiple market declines. So I know that how it feels to go through a down period in the market. But I also know if you stay the course, you're going to come out of it. But I know you need someone to keep walk you off the edge and tell you that. And people appreciate, I think, being told that. And they say, well, at least you've lived through several of these things, so I can kind of believe you. But so I think my age is actually an asset to some extent. My technology skills are still a little bit lacking. That's why I need people like yourself, Matt, and other people to help me. But the things that we've delegated my skills, my job to things I'm good at and things I like doing. It's a lot different from, you know, the old brokerage days when I was doing things I didn't like doing. So everything I do now, I really enjoy doing.
Well, let me embarrass you for a minute because I know you love it when I say nice things about you. Number one, you know, I got you in with the person who cuts your hair. And one time we were talking and I said, what do you think about Rick? And she said, you know, my fear is that they don't make people like Rick anymore. And I really think that is the case. You are a world-class human. You are a really exceptional person and you have made a huge difference in my life. You've made a huge difference in our team's life. We now have an office in Houston, Texas, and great people there. Great people here in St. Louis have grown tremendously. But I love your story. I love your experience and I love the generosity that you, the way you share it with others and the way you, it feels to me like your commitment now is really to not necessarily make your own life better, but to make other people's lives better, and not just our clients, but our team. And so we're all grateful to you. We're grateful to be a part of your world.
Well, thank you. I mean, I'm going to reciprocate a little bit because I think your skill set is what I've told you before, but, you know, you're the Bob Costas of the financial industry as far as how you communicate, you know, our message. And it's not easy to communicate because it is kind of, it's kind of complicated. I mean, people, it's easier to tell somebody, I want to recommend this stock or this thing because it's beating the market or something like that. It's an easier story to tell. To tell somebody, take the long view. It's all based on academic evidence, you know, empirical studies, you know, and you got to stick with it if it goes down. It's harder to tell, explain that message, but you've helped me and helped our firm do that. So I'd say we are a good team. I think that's one thing. I look back at my life and I think what has made me successful, and I think I figured it out. It actually happened to prepare for this podcast, really. I think if you believe, if the place you work at, you believe in their mission, and you really believe that what you're doing for that company is good for humanity, good for the consumer. If you like the people you're working with, you like those people, that's great, and you like the work you actually do at the job, if they all mesh together, you have a great life. Now, I feel very lucky at Anheuser-Busch and with our firm, I have all three of those things mesh. And I think that's fortunate. I talk to people, I tell them, if you get those three combinations, the mission of the firm, the people and what you do at your actual work, you have an unbeatable combination. You won't think it's work, which I think that's what I feel. It's not really work to me. It's really just, and having work and having personal time, the combination is great also. So I feel very fortunate. I mean, I look back on my life and I just think, you know, that guy Roz always says, you know, what is it, luck or is it skill? Is, you know, and I got to say, for me, it's both, but I think luck had a lot to do with my, you know, my success. And I don't really feel I'm that successful, but I do feel, I feel very content in my life. And so I feel, but I, so I just keep doing what I'm doing.
Well, thank you, Rick. Thank you for sharing your stories. And thank you for the time you've spent with me throughout our relationship. You know, one of the coolest things is when you feel understood, and we have a shorthand with one another that just, it's rare. It's really unique, and I'm super grateful. So thanks for doing this. Thanks for being on a podcast. Is this your first time being a guest on a podcast?
Oh, yeah, first time. First, yeah. And probably last, but yeah, sure.
Well, thanks, man. And thanks to everybody who listened to Take the Long View with Matt Hall and today Rick Hill. And if you like what you have heard here, please subscribe and consider following us on our Hill Investment Group newsletter. And until next time, thanks so much. What's the largest check you've ever written? Please note, the information shared in this podcast is not intended as advice. The intent is to share meaningful experiences. I am likely not your advisor, nor wealth manager, nor financial planner, and my opinions are my own and not necessarily shared by Hill Investment Group. Investing involves risk. Consult a professional before implementing an investment strategy. Thank you.